This is Holly Rice, and I think most everybody knows Holly and Andy and their family. They've been with us now a few years. And, man, Holly's story is such an encouragement. Holly raised knowing the Lord, loving the Lord. But it was just recently that she realized that had never become personal in her own life, had never truly trusted Christ to save her, and really got under the conviction of the Holy Spirit. I think, well, not maybe in choir practice one Wednesday night, and that very night she trusted Christ to save her. A great reminder to all of us to do what the Bible tells us to do, which is be sure of your salvation, test your faith. And so we're thankful that Holly heard the Lord call, and she humbled herself before the Lord, and the Lord has saved her. So Holly, upon your profession of faith in Jesus as your Savior and your Lord, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ into his death and raised to walk in new life.
Amen. That's such an awesome thing that we get to see every single week somebody be baptized, and we get to share that as a church family. Let's stand together. We want to begin this morning reading some scripture together as we start off. So let's read this together. Praise the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. He wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out heavens like a tent. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made. All you have made will praise you, O Lord. Your saints will extol you. They will tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might, so that all men may know of your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord is faithful to all his promises and loving toward all he has made. I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. Let's sing of the Lord's greatness this morning. How great is our God. Let's sing together the splendor of the King.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and dark tries to hide and trembles at his foot.
pray. Father, we bow before you, and as we start the most exciting week at Grace Life for the year, Vacation Bible School, it is our prayer that hundreds and hundreds of boys and girls and parents and grandparents would know that our God is great. God, give us grace. Give us the filling of your Holy Spirit to represent you well. We ask for that always, but especially this week. You will put so many tender and impressionable hearts and lives before us, and they'll be watching and they'll be listening when we don't even know it. And I pray, God, that what they see and what they hear would be the person of Jesus Christ in us and through us. Father, we are grateful for the opportunities that we have to serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords this week. But right now in this moment, we are most grateful that we get to be the kids, your kids, gathered together in this room to give praise to our Abba Daddy, to tell you how great you are, how good you are, and how faithful you are. So draw us close to yourself today and change our hearts and change our lives for our joy and for your glory. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Be seated. Welcome to Grace Life. It is the first day of the most exciting week that we have at Grace Life every single year. This room will be totally different here in just a few hours. This Vacation Bible School is going to be a little bit different than those in the past because all these chairs are going to be gone. We're having a big camp out in the room this week. It's a big backyard camp out all week long with hundreds of kids, hundreds of boys and girls here in this room. And in this camp out, we're going to do one thing, and that's to gaze into heaven and see how majestic and how good and how great our God really is as we look upon the stars and the sun and the moon this week. So it's a big backyard camp out in here. So right now y'all are sitting on the grass, and I'd appreciate it if y'all took care of it today, okay? Because we got lots of kids that are going to enjoy that this week, and lots of volunteers too, and lots of prayer warriors as well. And we always have these prayer bracelets. And I think some kids are going to be in the fireside room today. These are like neon green. And we really try to give these to people who your heart's here this week, but your body can't be here. And those bracelets have somebody's name on it that is going to be here volunteering. And it gives you the opportunity to be a prayer partner for them. And so if you're in the fireside room after the service today and you see some kids with those bracelets walking around and you're not going to be able to be here this week, run up to them and say, hey, I want to be a prayer partner. Give me one of those, okay? So it's going to be fantastic. Bible school orientation is today at 2 o'clock. Hopefully by then all the chairs will be out of here. And so Bible school orientation will happen in the fireside room. And so we're looking forward to a great time of just being able to connect today for a little while as Vacation Bible School volunteers. So please, please be here at 2 o'clock today for that. And also, Bible school again starts tomorrow, but then Friday night is the after party out at Shadow Lake, and it's going to be crazy good. We're super excited about this. We're kind of just taking it up about 100 notches this year, our celebration, and thought if you're having a camp out indoors all week long, why would you not have the after party outdoors, finally? So we have this beautiful piece of property called Shadow Lake where we're going to just go outdoors and enjoy God's creation and celebrate. So you'll want to make plans to be there hanging out with us on Friday night. Don't miss that. And then tonight at 6 o'clock, it's our prayer time, our monthly prayer gathering tonight, but there's not going to be a gathering. It's going to be just an opportunity for you to come in tonight at 6 o'clock and just walk through the building and just prayer walk. Just spend some time in this room and just walk and pray and go through the classrooms and through the hallways and even circle around the parking lot. One thing you can pray about is please no rain. That would make life a lot easier for us here because we use every square inch as it is, and the children would be heartbroken if they didn't get to go outside and play on the gravel. So we would appreciate not having any rain. So please help us pray for that. These are the Vacation Bible School shirts for this year, Grace Life Baptist Church. And then an oldie but a goodie here on the back, Matthew 24:14, says, when the gospel of the kingdom is preached to all the nations, then the end will come. And so that's where we came up years ago with this phrase, let's get it done and go home. Let's get the gospel to all the nations. Let's get that work done so we can go home. So we brought these back for Vacation Bible School this year, but not just for Vacation Bible School, but if you want one, you can have one as well for a great cause. You will be supporting our kids' camp, and you will be supporting our high schoolers, our 12th graders, our high school kids, rather. We're going to have high school kids serving as camp counselors at kids' camp this year, and so we want to be able to bless them and cover their cause for taking a week to serve the Lord like that. And so the proceeds from the t-shirts are going to support that effort. And so you can order t-shirts today and throughout this week, and we're going to order those next Monday, and they'll look just like this. And the way you do that is in the fireside room. Over far side of the room in there, against the window, there's a Vacation Bible School display, a table there, and you'll find some envelopes there to order your t-shirt. Just put your order in there, drop it in the box. But this is a great way to be a witness with a t-shirt on. It's also a great way to support our kids and our senior high kids as well. So looking forward to seeing lots of these shirts floating around our community. Hey, I'm glad you're here, and maybe you're kind of new to Grace Life, so we're especially glad that you're here. We're always happy to have guests and friends and family and neighbors here with us. And somebody might have handed you a worship guide as you came in today. I hope that they did. And you'll find on that worship guide, there's a tearaway tab. And if you have a prayer need or you'd like to know more about Grace Life, just let us know how we can contact you or how we might be able to assist you or serve you. And next Sunday is our Membership Matters class. And if you are interested in learning more about our Grace Life family, I would encourage you to come and hang out with us. It'll start at 10:45 next Sunday. And we'll feed you lunch. We'll take care of childcare. We wrap up around 2 o'clock. So just check the box there on the green tab. You want to be a part of that and give us a name and at least the email address so we can send you the information that you need to be a part of that. Bill and Judy, I thought we got rid of y'all, but here you are, like just a bad penny. Y'all keep coming back. We cried because y'all moved away and now you're here. Welcome. Glad you guys are here. Grace Life is like a boomerang church. You can't ever really leave. You always come back. You know, that's our story too. It was actually Vacation Bible School that brought me and Shannon back to Grace Life a long time ago. And so it's Grace Life has had a lot of people come to her through the years because of Vacation Bible School. The Craig family sitting right here on row number 2 through the ministry of Vacation Bible School. They became a part of our family. So can't wait to see what God has in store. Can y'all tell I'm a little geeked out? I'm really excited, man. I love this week. It's going to be incredible. So let's stand. Let's sing. I've already prayed. Let's just worship, man. I'm like too excited. I'm not too excited to pray. I just want to sing. All right. Let's just celebrate Jesus today. Amen. All right. Let's just have fun in the Lord today. All right. Just enjoy Him. He died that we might enjoy Him and bask in His glory and in His presence. So let's praise Him. Let's worship Him. Let's honor Him today.
Let's sing.
Show the world your love.
has given us His Holy Spirit to help us with that. And that's what this next song is about. It's called Overflow. It's talking about the Holy Spirit being so strong in our lives, so strong in what we do, that it overflows out of us, so that those around us can see the kingdom of God on display on this earth through us. Let's sing this song together.
Our boys and girls can come. Our ushers can come to receive our offering today as well. You guys are so quiet and orderly today. And then comes tomorrow. Of course, I'm kind of quiet and orderly today too. Then comes tomorrow. Hey, so two cards coming at you today. First one is the green card, which means today we're starting a new section. If you don't know what we're doing 52 questions in 52 questions in 52 weeks. about what we believe the Bible teaches us. And today we are hitting number 40. Coming to you. All right. Here comes the other ones. These are going to fall. I know it. Today we start talking about what we believe about the church. What do you believe about the church? Oh, gave you two. You want to share one? Did everybody get one? There you go, Nehemiah. What's up, man? You get two. Ready? So here's today's question, question number 40. What is the church, and here's a big word, universal? Okay? What is the church? Or you could say, sometimes we say the church invisible. There's what we call the universal or the invisible church. Here's what it is. The church universal is all the saved people. Now, what is a saved person? What does a person have to do to be saved? All right, not get baptized. All right, y'all hurt my heart right there a little bit. All right. We get baptized because we have been saved, right? Right? So to be saved, we repent from sin and turn to God. We trust Jesus. We ask him to save us. So the church universal is all the saved people, watch this, from all times, every tribe, tongue, people, and nation. So the church universal is everybody that has ever been saved, that will ever be saved, at all times, everywhere. How about that? That means we're part of the same church that Jesus' disciples are a part of. And we're part of the same church that today people in Kenya who have been saved are a part of, or in Russia have been saved, they're a part of, or in, you pick your favorite country, 1, 2, 3. Belize, Tennessee, amen, all right. That's a whole other people group, praise the Lord. All right, that's all I'm saying. Wrote that, all right. That went south fast, didn't it? What? So what is the church universal? The church universal is all the saved people from all times, every tribe, every tongue, every people, every nation. That means you and I, once we trust Christ to save us, we're part of one big church, one big family of brothers and sisters from all periods of life, from all periods of time, all walks of life, all over the world. That's pretty exciting. And heaven's going to be so beautiful because all of those people are going to be gathered together to be with God forever. Isn't that going to be amazing? That's why it's never going to get boring. We're going to get to know so many people with so many stories from so many walks of life. It's going to be fun. Well, one person from a faraway place is going to come and pray for us today, Mr. Gary McLean. Where are you from, Gary? Bessemer, Alabama. I thought the accent might throw them off.
Yeah.
Hey, speaking of baptism, by the way, because you guys mentioned baptism improperly, but you mentioned it. Gary is our deacon of the week. Sometimes kids ask me, what do our deacons do? Well, our deacons do a lot of different things. But one of the things, and I'll give you an example, Gary's our deacon of the week this week, which is why he's here doing this. But also, I'm baptizing, I don't know, y'all might know Olivia Booth, right? She's 10, and Olivia has trusted Christ to save her, and she's getting baptized after the second service today. And so I called Gary, and I said, hey, can we get, Olivia didn't want to get baptized in the lake. Can you blame her for that? It's kind of gross. It's fun, but it's gross. So she wanted to get baptized in the north. So I called Gary, and I said, hey, we're going to need the baptistry this week. So Mr. Gary came up here during the week, and he filled up the baptistry with water, and I think he heated it. I hope he heated it. And then he and some other deacons and their wives will be up there today with towels and all that kind of stuff, helping us out with that. So appreciate our deacons, as always. So, brother, you pray for us.
Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for this church, this chapter of a universal church, Lord, that you've continued to bless us. Lord, thank you for these children. Thank you for Vacation Bible School this week, that children and adults can be galactic starveyors. Lord, we know that you're the heavenly being that we're seeking, that we're looking for, Lord. I ask you to bless our tithes. Lord, I pray for the hearts that will be given this week in Bible school and today during our service. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Gary Mack. Thank you, guys. You know you got a good deacon when he knows the Vacation Bible School theme and prays it, right? Galactic Starveyors. That's good deaconship right there. Grace Life is blessed with all the people that serve in our Vacation Bible School. But Ed Bullard, he left, I guess. Did he get mad? Did he get mad? Ed can tell you that it is a joy to get to see as many men serve in our Vacation Bible School as we have serving. And you don't find that everywhere, but we're blessed in many ways. That's one of them. Hey, so Romans 12. Adam, why are you laughing? Romans 12. We started here January 1. Here we are, first Sunday of June, and we're still in Romans 12. And I never thought this. I really didn't. I thought when we launched into this that I would spend about 6 weeks in Romans chapter 12, and then God just kind of kept digging in deeper and deeper, and I've enjoyed the journey hanging out with you guys through Romans 12. Romans 12, last week we're in verse 14, 15, and 16. Let me just kind of back up and start there because they were some hard, a bit troubling passages that we looked at last week. Bless those who persecute you. That's a hard pill to swallow. Bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. Pray that God will bless them. Be happy with those who are happy and weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with each other. Don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people. And don't think that you know it all. We talked about those verses last week. How do we respond? As God's people, how do we respond to those people who want to bring pain and hurt and harm intentionally into our lives? And so we said three things last week that we do is we respond in a Christ-honoring way as gospel-saturated people. We respond to people that are seeking to intentionally hurt and harm us, one, by forgiving them. And we took some time last week to unpack that and exactly what forgiveness really kind of looks like, sort of a three-stage process where there's the act of the will that says I am going to forgive and I do forgive, and then the process where that becomes more and more real, where the will and the emotions kind of begin to line up, and then ultimately to that place of freedom and forgiveness where it really has become a reality. And so we said that we need to forgive those who are seeking to hurt us, and then we need to identify with them. Paul said there in verse 15, to when they weep, when those who persecute you weep, weep with them. And when those who persecute you rejoice, rejoice with them. And then in verse 16, we talked about all that can only happen if we humble ourselves, if we're not thinking that we're superior, because we would never perpetrate to somebody else what's been perpetrated to us. Sometimes then we begin to think of ourselves arrogantly and self-righteously, and we gave the example there toward the end of the sermon of the Pharisees with the stones in their hands who are ready to stone the woman who had been caught in the act of adultery. A big setup. And then Jesus says, well, let he who is without sin throw that first stone. So all the stones then hit the ground. So our role in this, when people are seeking to hurt and harm us, is to forgive them, to identify with them, and to humble ourselves. And that's exactly what Christ has done for us. He forgives us. He certainly identified with us. God left heaven and became a human being, walked among us, and bore our shame and our sorrows. He humbled himself, Philippians 2 says, and became obedient even to the point of death. So we should not expect anything less that the scripture calls us to live a life like this, because we are following the very one who sets the supreme example of living a life like that. And it's tough to do, no doubt about that. In fact, living like that is impossible to do on your own. On your own power, on your own strength, you're not going to live a life like that. You're not going to be a forgiving person. You're not going to seek to identify with your persecutors and those who have wounded you when they're hurting, when they're rejoicing. You will stiff arm those people rather than identify them if you're trying to do this on your own. And you won't walk in humility. You will walk with a sense of entitlement that something is owed to me. There ought to be payback that's happening here. If you try to live this on your own, you won't. But only by God's help, by the work of His Holy Spirit in us, can we live a life like that. So when you get a raw deal, when you get cheated out or you get cheated on, when lies are spread about you, when somebody else wins and you lose and you know it was rigged. You know, we used to like to say, I don't get mad, I get even. That's our natural inclination, you know, just to spit some beech nut in some dude's eye. That's 80s country music, y'all, if y'all. I'm an 80s guy. I don't listen to country music today, but me and Mama, we like to jam to some 80s country music. We don't go to a lot of concerts, but Alabama's Farewell Tour, boy, we were there. We were there. Roll on, that's all I'm saying. That used to be before Christ, and still is sometimes, unfortunately, our natural inclination to try to get even. And then we get to verse 17. This is where we stopped last week. We get to verse 17, and it's almost like the Holy Spirit is reading our minds. It's almost as if the Holy Spirit is reading our hearts. Fathom that. Imagine that, because He is. And He begins to warn us in verse 17 against the temptation that we face of wanting to get even, of wanting to pay other people back for what they've done to us. In verse 17, the text says, never pay back evil with more evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see you're honorable. Do all that you can to live at peace with everyone. Dear friends, never take revenge. Leave that to the righteous anger of God. For the scriptures say, I will take revenge. I will pay them back, says the Lord. Instead, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals of shame on their heads. Although everything in us wants to pay back those who have robbed us or cheated us or hurt us or harmed us, God steps in as a good father and He says, don't do it. Don't choose that path. Don't go down that road. You may think that getting back at somebody, paying them back, you may think that getting revenge or getting even is going to make life better, but in reality, it's like trying to put out a fire with a bucket of gasoline. It's only going to cause the evil to grow exponentially. Revenge only adds fuel to an evil fire, and God loves you too much to sit back and allow you to get burned. So God says, don't go into that way. He says, verse 17, never pay back evil with more evil. Now, does that mean that we should not persecute criminals? Does that mean that we should not persecute child abusers? That's not at all what that means. In fact, when we get to Romans chapter 13, we will see when we finally get there that it is none other than God Himself who establishes government and entrusts law enforcement and puts them into place so that justice can be executed. The difference between Romans chapter 12 and Romans chapter 13 is Romans 12 is dealing with personal relationships and personal disputes. Romans 13 is altogether different because it's dealing with civil disputes. Romans 12 is focusing on how the gospel is supposed to be changing the way we live our lives toward each other. So after God says, don't repay evil with evil, He then gives us some really good counsel about how we're to deal with difficult people and mean people and angry people, people that might seek to bring hurt and pain and harm into our lives. He says this in verse 17, the second part of 17. He said, do things in such a way that everyone can see that you're honorable. I like the way the New American Standard reads that. It says, respect what is right in the eyes of all men. In other words, if we think ahead of time about how is this going to look to other people, it might help us avoid a lot of negative situations. Y'all remember when the WWJD bracelets were really popular? They still should be. I know we kind of kid about it and joke about it sometimes, but that's not a bad thought to be carrying around with you. What would Jesus do in this moment? How would Jesus respond? What would he say? What would his tone be like? How would he handle this? When we think about what would be the right thing to do, that's a good place to start. How to live honorably in the sight of other people. My wife has often said probably one of the things, and I think this is true for me as well, although she was more committed to staying out of trouble than I was, but she didn't get into a lot of trouble growing up as a kid or as a teenager. You know why? Because she was always thinking about what would my grandparents think about this. It's a great thought to carry around with you. And Paul says here, do things in such a way that everyone can see that you're honorable. Somewhere between the extreme of being a people pleaser and being an all-out jerk is 17b right here. As the people of God, there should be a healthy concern in us for whether or not our lives are perceived as honorable by a watching world. Not that we're interested in the world thinking that we're honorable for our own sake and for our own selfish gain, not because we are interested in gaining friends and influencing people, but it ought to be important to us that a watching world takes note of our lives and would say that our lives are honorable because we want to represent Jesus well. We want them to see Christ in our lives. We want to be reminded that we represent Him on this planet, and we don't want to do anything that would misrepresent Him. If we just lived with that in view, if we just lived in view of that, that I want people to see Christ in me, I don't want to misrepresent Him in any way. I think the way that we would respond to people who do us wrong would be so much better. We so less frequently would escalate the evil and the meanness and the anger and the bitterness that gets perpetrated on us by throwing the gas on it, but rather we would cut its knees out from under it by being respectful and kind and honorable. Think about it as it pertains to social media. I mean, that just becomes a place where people just, it's like they're drunk. They suddenly feel the freedom to say anything they want to say. And oftentimes you may get hit with some harsh words and ugly things and anger and vitriol. And don't enter into that drunkenness where you just give that right back to them. God says, no, you act in a way that's honorable. Don't throw gas on that fire, but cut the knees out from under that by acting in a way that's honorable, compassionate, and kind. WWJP, what would Jesus post? All right, maybe that's the new one we need. That wasn't on the notes, that was free. That just... You're blessed to have an ADD pastor. You're welcome. And then in verse 18, God says in verse 18, do all that you can to live at peace with everyone. Do all that you can do to live at peace with everyone. That requires acting in an honorable way. This week, I didn't write this down exactly right, but there was somebody on the radio, I just caught a blip of it, and he was talking about Billy Graham. And when I was coming up, everybody seemed to love Billy Graham because that was later in his life and in his ministry. But when Billy was younger, he was, from what I'm told and have read, he was a pretty controversial sort of figure because back in those days, churches were kind of one of two directions. They were either really liberal and had kind of forgotten the gospel, or they were so conservative that they forgot that the gospel was intended to get to the lost, and they were just kind of in their holy huddle, keeping it to themselves. And then on the scene comes guys, he wasn't the only one, but Billy's the most famous one. God raised up people like Billy Graham who came on the scene and who said, we are going to believe the gospel, but we're not going to keep it to ourselves. We're going to get it to a lost and dying world. So Billy did crazy stuff. Like, he would go do these crusades in these cities, and he would have unsaved people sitting on the platform with him. You know, he would have like a local celebrity who may be known for doing things that, you know, you just wouldn't do in church. But Billy would have those people there because he was seeking, A, to influence the person there on the platform with him with the gospel, but he also knew the presence of that person on the platform might draw other people to that gathering where he would have an opportunity to influence them with the gospel. And I told you all that to tell you that. We all love Billy Graham now, but back when he was a young guy, a lot of people hated him. And a lot of people were really, really critical of his methods and what he was doing. And so he got a lot of hate mail back in the day. God bless them. They didn't have email in those days, or it would have probably really been crazy. But he got a lot of hate mail. And this guy this week, he said, this is how Billy Graham would respond to all that hate mail. And I didn't get it exactly right. I was driving and swerving and trying to remember it. But he said this. He would respond to those critics by saying, thank you for caring enough about me to be so forthright. I covet your prayers as I seek God's leadership in my life. That's good. That's really, really good. And then you know what he did? He went on about his business, right? Doing what God had called him to do. But he acted in a way that was honorable. He didn't throw gas on the fire, but showed kindness and respect and honor. 18, God says, do all you can to live at peace with everyone. That should be our goal. To live at peace and harmony with everybody, both believers and unbelievers. And as we strive for that, it's probably going to lead us to one of two places. One, as we're striving for peace with everybody, first of all, it may lead us to a place where we got to let something go. You just got to let something go. You can't keep making a big deal out of something that really doesn't deserve to be made a big deal about. We've got a phrase among our pastors called LIB. It stands for let it be. Just let it be. Just move on. You gotta let something go. This idea is I need to overlook an offense. I know that's contrary to our world today. I mean, I got the bird in the parking deck at UAB last night. Don't even know what I did to offend the dude. He didn't think he should overlook whatever I had done. And I'm picking him out, but you know what? I'm just as guilty, not of giving the bird. I don't do that. But I'm just as guilty of some little offense of just kind of camping out on that. God says, listen, if you're going to live at peace with everybody, sometimes you got to let some things go. We got to be willing to drop some things, overlook some things. We got to be okay with saying, you know what, I'm not going to hold on to this because God knows it, and so I'm going to hand the justice ball to him. I'm going to let him do with this whatever it is that he wants to do, however he sees fit. Doing all I can to live at peace with everyone means that it's my responsibility. That any antagonism, that any fueling of the conflict isn't coming from me. I need to make sure that I'm not inciting conflict or compounding conflict or adding to the conflict. Think about it. How many relationships, how many friendships, how many marriages, how many churches have ended because of some small thing that nobody was willing to let it go? Nobody was willing to overlook it. Nobody called LIB on it and just let it be. Instead, evil was returned for evil. And anything in that that was good got burned down. How often have we seen that? So sometimes the way to peace is to let something go. And maybe you're here today and it's just the day that you got to let something go. It's been sticking in your craw for far too long. You're wasting your time. You're wasting your energy. You're wasting opportunities. Just let it go. L-I-B. Move on. Sometimes you got to let things go. Sometimes the way to peace is to let go and show mercy and grace. Is that always going to work? No. No. And listen, when that doesn't work, listen to me, Christian. God is not asking you to be a doormat. God's not asking you to adopt a peace at any price kind of mentality. Do all you can to live at peace with others. Do all you can to work toward reconciliation. But that requires two people agreeing on reconciliation. You can't have peace if the other person is determined to have war. Peace is not always possible. So sometimes you got to let it go, and sometimes you got to let them go. There are angry people who always pick fights. Eventually, you just got to get out of their way. Because they're battles with themselves, not with you. You're not the issue. You're not the problem. And you can't fix it. Is there somebody in your life who continues to insist on poking you in the eye every time they see you? You know, the Bible doesn't say you got to keep letting that happen. It does say that some people are toxic. The Bible says in Psalms 58, their venom is like the venom of a snake. Do you think God would have you continue to go get snake bit over and over and over again? Forgive, yes, but forgive doesn't mean reconcile. You can't reconcile if they don't want it. You can't reconcile if it's not peace, if they only want their way and not peace, you can't reconcile with that. If all they want is war, you can't reconcile with that. Having somebody that is bent, bound, and determined to always be at odds, it's like having a toxic person in your life, and that's going to mess with your attitude. It's going to mess with your relationships. It's going to mess with your life. People who are toxic, here's what you know this, they blame everybody but themselves. And they may love to blame you for their pain, but it's not you, it's them. It's not always easy to live at peace. There are still some people, no matter what you do, they're still going to poke you in the eye. And God says, you need to realize that's not about you. After you've done all that you can do, sometimes you got to move on. You got to move on. You can't spend your life trying to please perpetually aggrieved people. You can't. Thank God for the wise people in this church who through the years have pulled me to the side and said, you can't form your ministry around perpetually aggrieved people. And you can't yours either. You can't live your life that way. God says, do everything you can do to live at peace with everyone. And then God says, your job in that is to work for peace, not revenge. And then God says, the paying people back part and the getting revenge part, that's not your job. That's God's job. So you take that one off your to-do list. Somebody right now just needs to, because you're thinking, this person, I'm going to pay them back. I'm going to get them back. I'm going to get, I don't even know what beech nut is, but I'm going to spit it in their eye. Pastor said. Maybe you got that on your list today. Just go ahead and scratch that off your list, because God is clearly saying that's not on your to-do list. That's not in your job description. God's not giving you that to do. That's his job. Payback. Revenge belongs to God. Verse 19, he says, dear friends, never take revenge. Leave that to the righteous anger of God. For the scriptures say, I will take revenge. I will pay them back, says the Lord. What this means is that when you love your enemy and they don't repent, and they don't receive the blessing of your love, don't you for a minute think, well, man, evil won. I blessed, I forgave, I prayed, I identified, I humbled myself, and they still poking me in the eye. You'll be tempted to go, well, good got triumphed by evil. Good never gets triumphed by evil. You'll be tempted to think that in that moment, but you would be wrong. Evil never wins. Why? Because God always wins. Always, always, always wins. And here's how God always wins. On his football team, Y'all know I like football. On God's football team, he's got these two amazing running backs. Over here on his right side, he's got this running back by the name of Mercy. And over here on the left side, he's got this running back by the name of Justice. And here's the opposition lined up in front of them. And God will turn and he will hand the ball to Mercy. And Mercy will take that ball, and sometimes Mercy just runs right over somebody, gets in the touchdown, and there's victory. Oh, my goodness. There's repentance. There is celebration. There is reconciliation. There is peace. There is harmony. Mercy has won the day. But sometimes Mercy takes the ball, and Mercy hits that defense, and Mercy doesn't get anywhere. Well, see, that defense has got free will. Mercy gets the ball again. 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 And Mercy ain't getting anywhere. God steps back in the huddle and he goes, Mercy's done everything Mercy can do. Justice, it's your turn. And God turns and he hands the ball to his Justice. Justice has never been tackled. The justice of God has never been stopped. The good King James word is thwarted. The justice of God has never been thwarted, never been tripped up. When God finally says, Mercy's done all mercy can do, he turns and he gives the ball to Justice. And Justice will have the final say. God says, that's my job. Paying back. Vengeance. Justice. So listen, church, you don't need to worry about being the judge. We have a judge. And on the last day, you will be in the celebration of his victory. So God says revenge and payback is his job. And then God says in verse 20, here's your job. Instead, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. And if they're thirsty, give them something to drink. God says, you just keep going Mercy. You got one running back in your ball, on your ball team, Mercy. God's got two, Mercy and Justice. You keep going Mercy. You feed them. You give them something to drink. You forgive them. You bless them. You do whatever you can do. And sometimes that means the best mercy you can give them is distance and silence, all right, just to go back to that. Because somebody in the room is being abused or has been abused. You're carrying all kinds of pain. And if you're not hearing me closely, you're going to hear me say, you got to keep trying, keep trying, keep trying, keep trying. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that's the rule, but there are exceptions to the rule. There comes a time. There comes a time when mercy is best displayed with, well, now you get my prayers and my distance. That's the most mercy at this point I can muster. So I just want to be clear about that. These are texts, these are passages of scripture that may be best fleshed out with you and some godly people sitting together and talking through, or a pastor talking through. And I'm trying to do the best I can, but I'm talking to hundreds of people about some very complex kind of situations. So I'm trusting the Holy Spirit here to bridge this huge gap between my ability and your heart. God says, you keep giving them mercy. You know why? Because even evil people know when they're getting mercy instead of justice. And sometimes those evil people will melt in their tracks, because mercy is a strong thing. Grace is a strong thing. If you don't believe me, how did you get saved? It was his grace that won you over. It was his mercy that won you over. Loving our enemies, showing them mercy, caring for them is the most powerful witness of Christ that we can offer to anybody. I know you want to say, but do you know what they did? Probably not, but I'm betting that it feels inexcusable. Awful. So you giving them comfort and giving them food and drink and showing them mercy and grace and love seems outrageous. I know. But it might help you if you can remember this. You may want to write this down. Unconditional love is not the same as unconditional approval of behavior. Unconditional love is not the same as unconditional approval of behavior. Isn't that how God loved us? With unconditional love, without unconditionally approving of our behavior. He continues on in verse 20 and he says, "In doing this, you will heap burning coals of shame on their heads." Now, this is a weird piece of information here to deal with. And there's been a lot of people who've written that when people would repent, when they felt sorry for what they did, when they wanted to turn, they would put hot coals in a pan on their head and they would walk around and carry that around. And so we're tempted to take that interpretation because that interpretation says, yes, love wins the day. People always repent. They always turn. But they don't. Furthermore, there's no biblical evidence that we have to say that that's what that means. By heaping coals on their head, that person is sorrowful and they're repenting and they're ashamed of what they've done. Our aim in loving our enemy, yes, is to bless them, forgive them. Bless those who persecute you, Paul said, bless and don't curse. Our first and most urgent longing for our enemies is that our enemies would be blessed, that they would be saved, that they would be rescued, that they would trust Christ. That's our goal. In fact, that's the goal of all of chapter 12 here, that our lives would be lived by the power of the gospel in such a way that people would see Jesus and turn to him and would enjoy him forever. That's the whole point of Romans chapter 12. But that's not the whole picture, see? Because in verse 19, Paul says, "Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord." So when we get to verse 20 and we hear that loving our enemies will bring burning coals on their head, then we've got to realize that living life like this, where we are giving it to our one running back over and over again, mercy, 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 toward that enemy of ours is going to result in one of two ways. Ready? If our enemy repents, guess what they get from God? Mercy and blessings. The very thing we've been praying for. We want to see that God blesses them. So if our enemy repents, they get mercy. They get blessings. But if they don't repent, they get justice. They get judgment. They get wrath. Not from us. We don't have that running back in our backfield. They get justice and judgment and wrath from God. If when you show love to your enemy, and they reject that, they're rejecting the mercy of God. And if you reject God's mercy, I believe what the text is saying here, you continue to reject the mercy of God. You begin to accrue upon your life the hot coals of God's justice. You begin to accrue upon yourself the hot coals of God's judgment and God's wrath. It's as if every rejection of God's mercy becomes just another hot stone of justice and judgment and wrath that God puts on a person's head. And it may be possible, in fact, I think it's probable, that the more mercy a person rejects, the more coals of fire will be heaped on their head. Now, that's not our desire or aim. If you get to this passage in Scripture and you're like, yes, I'm going to show mercy because I want Jesus to scorch them, you're not showing mercy. Remember this. God is looking at your heart. It's the internal attitude of your heart. That's not a merciful heart. That's not a merciful attitude. So this is not like divine permission to outwardly act like you love your enemy, but inwardly hoping God's going to use all this to scorch them. No, no, that's not the heart. That's not the attitude that we want to come at this with. That's not our desire. That's not our aim. Our aim is verse 14. God, I want you to bless them. I want you to forgive them. Change their hearts. Save them, God, from sin and from themselves. And for that, to see another person saved. Look, to see a person that hates you. To see them come to faith in Christ. Isn't that something we ought to be willing to give our very lives for? Isn't their eternal life more important than your temporal life? That's something that countless missionaries for the last 2,000 years have done. They've gone to people who have hated them and hated their cause and hated their message, and over again, they laid their lives down to see that person come to faith in Christ. Jim Elliot through Gates of Splendor, for example, comes to mind that some of you may know. That ought to be our heart. That ought to be our aim. That ought to be our mission. But what verse 20 is saying is this: if it looks like your love has failed, if it looked like the mission of Jim Elliot failed, when the people that he was trying to show the love of God to murdered him and murdered his partners in the ministry, if it looks like it fails, it looks like it fails in your life, you fail to convert your enemy, and your enemy hates you more and even wants to kill you or does kill you, be assured you have still not been overcome by evil. You have overcome the evil. You can't tell me when the missionary Jim Elliot goes to these people who he loved and wanted to see them in eternity with himself forever, and he goes to these people and they murder him, that he stands before Jesus and Jesus goes, "Evil whooped you, son." No, he whooped evil. The outcome doesn't matter on our side of eternity. Christ will get the victory. His justice will always win. Always win. God will have the last word, not your enemy. And by the way, you should read the Jim Elliot story if you're not familiar with that, because the wives of those men ended up going back to that tribe, won them to Christ. And there's a flourishing faith community in that place. And that's happened in the last 60 years. But even if that had never happened, evil still didn't win. Evil never wins because God never loses. God always has the last word. Real quick, verse 20 reminds me of two things about God that I just want to make abundantly clear today. Number one, our God is a God of mercy. Aren't you glad? I mean, how often to me is he going, "Mercy, mercy, mercy." And there I am, my stubborn, stupid self. And God just keeps giving it to him. Oh, mercy comes back, tongue hanging on the ground. "Give it to justice, God, give it to justice." He goes, "No mercy, you up again, man. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for mercy." He is merciful. The Bible is clear that before Christ rescued us, guess what we were to him? Enemies. We were his enemies. And while God tells me and you to give our enemies food and drink, God gave us, his enemies, his son, his only son. We are to give our enemies food and drink, and God says we need to be reminded, when God gives us the food and drink of the Lord's Supper, be reminded of who he gave us. Not just food and drink. He gave us Jesus. That's a God that's rich in mercy. But we also need to stop here in verse 20 and remember this. Not only is God a God of mercy, but he's also a God of justice. This part of his character doesn't get a lot of press these days. Everybody prefers this running back. This one not so much, but this one is real and undefeated. If you embrace his mercy, you get mercy. But if you reject his mercy, and I don't know how many times mercy's going to get the call in your life. I don't know. I don't know that, and you don't either. But I believe what the Bible teaches is that mercy is going to get one last call in your life. There comes a point when you won't get to reject his mercy anymore because his mercy's not running at you anymore. And the only thing running from God to you at that point is going to be his justice, his judgment, his wrath. Nobody in this room gets to get around having to deal with God. Nobody in this world gets to get around having to deal with God. Nobody. God gets the last word. And the last word for some is mercy. And the last word for others is justice. What makes the difference is what you as his enemy did with the food and the drink that he offered you. What you did with the bread and the wine that he offered you. Because the bread that he offered you is the body of his son. And the drink, the wine that he offered you, is his shed blood for you. God offers you his son. Receive him. Take, eat, and drink. Embrace Christ. Embrace Christ. And never see God's justice coming like a freight train at you. Or keep turning away from his mercy. And hot coals stacking up. AKA, mercy's just getting a running start. Does that make sense? This is not what God desires. The scripture is clear. God desires that all men would embrace his mercy and be saved. His justice at a running start at any human being is not what he wants. He's offered you food and drink, eternal food and drink, eternal mercies, eternal grace through his son, Jesus Christ. Have you embraced Jesus? The mercy of God in his son, Jesus. Everlasting life. His justice against your sin set aside from you and instead given to Jesus. Have you embraced Jesus to save you? God is sovereign. And he will have the last word over your life. It will be mercy or it'll be justice. And it has nothing to do with your behavior. It has nothing to do with your performance. It has everything to do with the performance of his son at the cross. What you do toward his son determines what his last word over your life will be and of those that you know and love. Let's pray. Lord, we want to thank you today for your word. And Lord, thank you that by your power we can love our enemies and we can pray for them and we can forgive them and we can bless them and we can strive again and again to live at peace with all people. And that gives hope to us today, God, to stay the course and to continue to love with your love. To continue to forgive and identify with those who may hate us or want to harm us. But Lord, I want to thank you that there's comfort in this life and there's comfort in what we face in life so often is unfixable situations. God, we do what we can do and we back up and we try again and we try again and we try again. And where we find comfort today in knowing that you don't put the responsibility to change a life on our back. You don't put the responsibility of getting the ball across the goal line on us, but that you will have the last word. So God, we want to be gracious and merciful, and we want to love people with the kind of love that is just no other word for it. It's of God. It's miraculous. It doesn't make sense to this world. And we want to do that while we hold on to the reality that you won't let us be defeated. You won't let us be overcome by evil. But that if we will continue to walk in the power of your Spirit and follow your Son Jesus, we will do exactly what verse 21 says. We will not be overcome by evil, but we will overcome evil with good. Lord, I pray that today every person under the sound of my voice has said yes to your mercy revealed in your Son Jesus Christ. God, if there is anybody here that has never said yes to that mercy, I pray that today they would. They don't know how many more times your mercy's coming at them. And even this very day, this very word could be the last time. So turn us to yourself today, God, while it's still today. May our rock-solid confidence in your sovereignty set us free to live lives that are pleasing to you in a hard, dark, mean world. May people see the light and the love of Jesus Christ in us for your glory, for their good, for our joy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand. If you've never trusted Christ, you've never embraced His mercy, I would ask you to consider that today. I'd love to talk to you about that. Maybe there's a difficult person that you've been dealing with, and today you have got to be the one to make the decision to let it go. Just drop it. It's not worth it. Just move on. Let it go. Overlook it. Forgive it. And move on. And maybe somebody's even thinking, well, maybe there's a relationship that it's time that I end it. That's severe. That's a last resort. Before you make that step, much time needs to be spent with the Lord in His Word and in prayer. Maybe that process starts today. Maybe there's still a breakthrough yet that God's going to bring. Maybe it's still too soon to give up. And if nothing else today, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, lift your eyes to heaven and rejoice in who our God is. That He is a God that has saved us by His mercy, and He is a God who has promised to make all wrongs right. Amen? Amen. Let's worship Him. He's worthy.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turned which more the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
His wounds have paid my ransom. Is it possible that God may use your wounds to help rescue another? Is it possible that the wounds that you carry and the hurt and the harm that you carry in your life, the evil that has been done to you, just like the evil that was done to Christ there on the cross, is it possible that if you'd put all that in His sovereign hands, that He would use your hurt, your pain, your wounds, your story to bring salvation, to bring healing, to bring hope to somebody else? How many of you today just carry some wounds in your life, just some hurt, some pain? You're carrying it now. You just carry it all the time. Just lift them up. Just hold them up. Let's pray for each other. Lord, I want to pray for wounded people in this room, hurting people. God, we all bear the scars of what evil has done to us, and a lot of our wounds are self-inflicted. But God, we are walking wounded people, but we follow a Savior who is also wounded. And Lord, we want to give you today our wounds, our hurt, our scars, our pain. We don't want to continue to claim it as our own and dwell in it and waste away in it. It's real, no doubt. And we want to give it in all of its reality to you today. Say, God, do with all of this whatever you wish. Change me and change others with your glorious freedom and grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Whew. Romans 12. I didn't really unpack 21 a whole lot. Can we just say I did it so I can move on? Because I'm tired, man. Romans 12, God has been so good, so good. I've had to deal with a lot in my life through that journey. And I thank God for that, right? And I hope you've had to deal with a lot in Romans 12 too. If you did, good news is that means God loves you. And you were paying attention. That's good news for me. It's encouraging. Hey, I love you. God bless you guys. Have a great day today. It's going to be a great week this week at Grace Life. Come be a part of that.